Hello from the hilltop. Welcome to today's Alumni Career Services webinar broadcast, Jesuit Ideals and Ethical Principles Animating Our Classrooms, with Julia Farr, college class of 1988, and parent to Hoya's classes of 2019, 2021, and 2024, executive director of the Georgetown University Alumni Association, Maggie Little, senior research scholar at the Kennedy Institute of Ethics and professor of philosophy at Georgetown, and Father Peter Folan, SJ, assistant professor in the Department of Theology and Religious Studies. Thank you so much for being with us today. I'm Sarah Smith, senior associate director of Alumni Career Services, and I'll be facilitating today's webinar. Before I turn things over to our webinar hosts and speakers to get today's session underway, I want to remind you all that this webinar is being recorded and the recording will be made available to all registrants within 48 hours of this broadcast on our Alumni Career Services YouTube channel. Thanks so much for submitting your questions for our panelists during registration. To submit further questions and comments during the session, please use the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. Finally, if you're having any technical difficulties, please submit those concerns to me via the questions area as well. And you'll notice in the GoToWebinar control panel a handout containing full bio information for all of our presenters. That handout was also emailed to all registrants yesterday. Without further ado, I'm pleased to welcome and introduce Julia Farr, Executive Director of the Georgetown University Alumni Association. Julie is a graduate of the college class of 1988 and is the mother of three Hoyas, classes of 2019, 2021, and 2024. In her role, Julie oversees the broad portfolio of alumni engagement programs of the GUAA, including those from the Regional Engagement, Alliances, Career Services, Lifelong Learning, and Georgetown University Law Center teams. Julie has worn many hats during her professional life, serving as a regional alumni officer for Georgetown, a dedicated class ambassador for the class of 1988, a corporate securities attorney and executive, a fashion entrepreneur, and past president of the Georgetown University Alumni Association. She brings with her a wealth of experience, a global perspective, and most of all, a deep passion for and dedication to Georgetown. Julie, I'm so thrilled to turn things over to you now to get our session underway.
Thank you, Sarah, and thank you to all of you joining us today. As Sarah mentioned, I have a daughter who's a senior in the college and a son who's a freshman in the college this year, in addition to a daughter who graduated in 2019. I'm right here with you as a parent navigating these challenging times and helping our children navigate them as well. But I am very excited to have with us today and to introduce to you Maggie Little and Father Peter Folan and hear from them throughout today's webinar. Their bios are much too long for me to go into fully right now. They're so very accomplished, we would run out of time. But as Sarah said, they've been provided in advance and I'll share with you some of the highlights. Dr. Maggie Little is a senior research scholar, professor of philosophy, and the director of the ethics lab at Georgetown's Kennedy Institute for Ethics. As one of her many roles, Maggie guides the focus of the lab's coursework on an annual basis, pushing her colleagues and by extension her students to examine the world's most pressing, complex programs. And she's one of the faculty members leading development of a new suite of majors and minors in tech and society. Father and Dr. Peter Folan is a Jesuit priest and an assistant professor in Georgetown University's Department of Theology and Religious Studies. He teaches the beloved course, Problem of God, as well as Divine Revelation and other undergraduate classes as well. It's great to be with both of you today. Thank you for joining us. So Maggie, I'm going to begin with you. You had to completely rebuild your ethics course during this pivot to a virtual world. Tell us more about that experience and how you think through a delivery model for your course.
Yeah, first of all, a welcome to all of you parents out there. I'm also a parent of a recently graduated college student and one who's still in there. So I too am right there with you guys. So Juliet mentioned, So I was set to teach an intro to ethics class, which is a zero level, right? First experience ever of philosophy and ethics. And it's that one happens to be a large class. I usually teach small 25 to 30 person classes, but this was, I'd agreed to take a turn for the philosophy department at teaching 130 students. Then the pandemic hits. And the first thing is I was realizing that just hit me is, all the technical challenges and having to redesign for an online platform, right? But then really starting to think through what is it to support students at a time like this? I knew what my own kids were going through. And then George Floyd's murder happened. And for many of us, right, it was sort of another pause. And then I was thinking ahead, knowing that we were all, the students and I were going to go through the election together. So I just thought, I honestly, for me personally, and I shared this with my students, I came to this realization. I remember the day it occurred to me. I asked myself the question, what is it to teach an intro to ethics course in the way Georgetown does it at this moment in history? And the TAs and I just, like, we rebuilt the course from scratch. We wanted to use it as the terrible crises, right? As ways of an invitation to see what philosophy, ethics, the humanities can offer by way of tools to help us understand and articulate, grapple with, and maybe advocate better on behalf of issues that the students actually experience in their real lives. So the course was three units: pandemic, that's what we started with, then racial reckoning in America, and then divided democracy, right? Which, as I said to the students, was nothing about where you are on the political spectrum. In fact, it's about how we can engage better on the political spectrum, but how we understand threats to democracy and what makes it more resilient. Then the last thing I'm going to say is, well, I'm sure it's not the last thing, but by way of introduction. So then I just had this belief that we all could process together what was happening, because none of us wanted the pandemic to happen. None of us wanted the dreadful events that surrounded George Floyd's murder to happen. All of us are in distress about the depolarization of our country, and our poor students are right in the middle of all that. But it's also like the most amazing learning moment you could imagine for somebody who does the humanities. I mean, I was saying to Julie earlier, it's almost like a microcosm of the human condition. You know, humanity has faced challenges and problems before and gone through it. So the last thing we did was a leitmotif through the entire semester was about resilience and hope. So it wasn't just, let's look at, you know, a march through depressing topics. It's, with the pandemic, let's name things like inequities and harms that people are facing, but also the concept of narrative disruption, right? That even if you were lucky enough to escape, right, having a loved one who was ill or loss of job or housing insecurity, your life just got turned upside down, and there are concepts that can help name that. And then what is the nature of hope that can be resilient in the face of profound uncertainty? Which, by the way, Julia, just was talking to the students of the last class, and they said resilient hope was their favorite concept of the entire semester.
Is that right?
And then we continued that sort of arc toward staring at hard, difficult issues, right? As a community, and this was, I mean, Black students, white students, non-Black students of color, rich students, poor students, immigrants, we were a diverse community. But even through the racial reckoning then and divided democracy, with an arc toward what can humans do with this? So with racial reckoning, we talked about moral repair. Mm-hmm. What is it for a community to have honest, truthful conversations that ultimately can lead to reconciliation? And how do we heal our broken democracy? So it was, it's probably the most meaningful class I've taught in my 25 years.
And I'm captivated. I wish I could have been a part of it, because as history is unfolding and to be discussing and be in dialogue as a community as it's happening, I know must have been powerful for your students. Let me ask a quick question before I pivot to Father Peter. How did you handle the pandemic part? Because it was happening. We have some history to the others as models for behavior, but how did you handle the pandemic part with your students? Because we didn't know how this was all going to play out, and we still don't.
Yeah. So we actually talked about that, and I did remind them that again, we're humanity, right? Pull way back, zoom way back. We've been through plagues before, literally, and I read them passages of people who were keeping diaries during the Spanish influenza of 2018 or back on the bubonic plague, right? And seeing real-time memoirs from that, of people who, again, at their point in history, they didn't know what the end game was. They didn't know when it was going to get better. So what we're experiencing is what they experienced then, of profound uncertainty. I mean, the layers of uncertainty. When will it end? Will it get worse? is it okay to hope, or are we just being foolish, is actually something that humans, again, have been through time and again. But then we also really talked about, on one column, the uncertainty, and on the other column, because intro to ethics, I do a lot of bioethics at the same time, and I hang out with vaccinologists on a grant. So we talked through the science as the vaccine news was rolling out, and the politicization and distrust and mistrust, and not to make fun of it, but to try to understand humans need to trust before they'll believe. And so looked at trust as a concept as well.
And in this time when when news is happening and being distributed in the very second that it's happening, that has to be, I mean, so different from the other four more plagues that our society has lived through. But
yes, we did talk social media platforms and what responsible platforms look like. Yes, we're teaching a whole class on that in the spring, by the way. Yeah.
Okay, Father Peter, you teach one of the most beloved, anticipated, and talked about courses for Georgetown students, Problem of God. My son Peter happens to be in your class as a freshman. It's a foundational class at Georgetown and one that alumni are absolutely most nostalgic about. How have you been able to deliver one of the most cornerstone classes in a way that is still impactful over Zoom?
Well, thanks for that question, Julie, and thanks for having me here. Maggie, it's so great to be with you as well. And to everybody who's tuning in, greetings. I hope all is well with where you are. As you say, I teach your son. It's such a delight to teach Peter, and my whole Problem of God class is just, they're fantastic students. I'm trying to think a little bit about how some Jesuit principles I'm trying to bring to bear, both in terms of the content of the class, but also the pedagogy. I guess a couple things would come to mind for me. The first is this phrase that the early Jesuits would have used. It's called the ministrations of the word. So St. Ignatius Loyola, the founder of the Jesuits, so operating in the 16th century, he and the early Jesuits realized we want to be about the service of the word, kind of speaking, writing, but we know there's a lot of ways to do that. There's lectures, there's homilies, there's one-on-one conversations, there's larger group conversations, spiritual conversation. And so a variety of ways to deliver different material. And so I thought about a little bit of that this semester, because at least theology often operates in terms of assessments and things like that in papers. And that's vitally important. And so that writing is a significant component of my class. But also ways to deliver material with oral examinations, or I call them conversations. That's a bit of a euphemism. They're really oral exams. But also audio projects and visual ones, which I actually am encouraging students to do in groups. Peter, in fact, has done them in groups before, to put together a podcast, or I've had people with the visual project do a video. I've had people do paintings. I've had people do comic strips about a variety of things. And I find that with the technology they have available to them now, and especially the inability to connect with students from all over the place. I have a group with a meeting tomorrow with four of them. One is in Germany, one is in Rhode Island, one is in Nevada, and then one is in California. We'll all be on the same Zoom to talk about their final project. And so those different ways of presenting material is one. I think of another, this is a big Jesuit phrase, one hears it a lot, cura personalis. It often gets rendered the care of the whole person, kind of mind, body, spirit, psyche, everything like that. And that's not a bad rendering. I probably think a better one is a care for the person as a particular person, kind of a tailor-made care for who exactly you are. And so one way, I wasn't sure how well this would work in my class, but I committed to starting both of my courses this semester with meeting with each student one-on-one for 20 minutes over Zoom. And I knew it was going to be a fair amount of time. I wasn't sure how it was going to go, if it was going to be awkward, struggling for conversation. It was fantastic. And that's something that previously I wouldn't have done. I'm sure I would have had time certainly to get to know all the students within the first couple of days, but a one-on-one 20 minute with each student, I don't know if that would have happened. Certainly didn't happen last year. So I find that to be fascinating, that our first conversation was kind of on a student's turf, so to speak, and to hear about what was going on in his and her life, family, concerns about the semester. And because Problem of God is so largely first-year students, to get to hear how excited these students were to be at Georgetown. And I thought, my gosh, if you're this excited when you're not on the hilltop like you want to be, boy, it's going to be that much better still when finally you arrive here, which of course is what we all want. This isn't the year any of us wanted. And maybe just one last thing I'd mention, and this is a real particular thing to Zoom, of course, is the Zoom breakout rooms. I'm a big fan of the Zoom breakout rooms because at least my experience in class can be people choose a seat on the first or the second day and they more or less stay there for the whole semester. And so if you have people break out into conversations, they're hearing the same voices all the time. Breakout rooms are nice. You can mix that around. People are hearing different opinions on things. And I can see how groups align for these projects. These are students who don't agree on everything, but they're coming together to work. And who knows if that would have happened otherwise. So some of those are just a little bit of a glimpse into at least how I'm trying to appropriate this foundational course at Georgetown during a time of Zoom.
Two quick things about Peter's experience in your class. One is that he said he really appreciated the breakout rooms, that it was the time when you kept seeing familiar faces, that at first it's awkward, but then you keep getting put in a room with someone, and then all of a sudden you're talking to them and you're getting to know people. And that was a great experience he had. He's also been walking around the house with glue sticks and cutting and pasting things. I said, I didn't know that you were taking an art class. And he said, no, it's Father Folan's problem.
Let's be clear, glue sticks are not required, though they're optional.
That is. Well, thank you. So what have you seen now that you've been in the virtual classroom for a while? What has surprised you the most? I've been sitting with my kids, as I mentioned, last spring. I was caring for my father during this time, and I ended up sharing a room with my daughter, Cecilia, who was a junior. And I feel that we took five courses together as we shared a room, The Age of Nero, World War III, Eros et Caritas, Monuments and Memories. And I would sit and listen to the classes, and I really learned along with her. And we had these discussions at dinner we would have never had before. And yesterday I walked in the kitchen and Peter and Cecilia were sitting side by side because they take Julius Caesar together. And they were just sitting, and it was the last day of class, and they were leaning into the Zoom together. And that's something that wouldn't have happened either, my freshman and my senior taking a class like that. Anyway, so I had this sort of a surprising benefit from this experience. What's been surprising for the two of you? Either one can jump in.
Well, I can get us started. A number of things have been really pleasantly surprising. Like I said, one of them is that students are excited to be students here at Georgetown. Obviously, they're not excited about Zoom, whereby they're saying, you know, let's not even come back to campus, let's just stay on Zoom. Well, of course, that's not the case. But they're engaging the material that I'm asking them to engage. I decided this semester that I wanted to lean a little bit more heavily for some unit assessments on actual books, as opposed to, let's say, a lengthy article or something like that. And some of it was designed to try to move people away from screen time and to really sit and to read a book. I mean, I had a student just the other day say, it's been a little while since I've actually sat down and read a full novel, but I'm really glad I did and actually have the book in hand. And that's been a wonderful surprise to get to see how students want to engage their. I feel like they're rooting for this style of education. They want this to work. And that energizes me as well. And so that's been something I've really enjoyed with them. And then to see maybe the last part is how they get to know one another. One of the things I love about Georgetown, I've taught about it in a number of different places, but I saw this both in the brick and mortar classroom and in the Zoom classroom, is that Georgetown students are regularly referring to what other students say, and they're always using their names. I love that. Not he said or she said this. It's, you know, Maggie said this, and then Julie asked this great question. And it creates a community that I guess it's not surprising anymore because I've seen it each semester here, but in a way, it is always surprising to hear it and delightful.
Great.
Lovely. I think one of the things that surprised me the most for my class is how much students shared and how honest they were. So again, a larger class, looking at really challenging issues, including issues that, I mean, part of the point of the class was to look at divisions, right? Different experiences and knowledges and beliefs. And as I said to them, to engage respectively, which means if you don't have the experience and the knowledge of that person, there's a lot of, you know, listen and learn, but don't freeze as though you can't engage it, because that's not respectful either. So we really worked out what are ways to do that. And one of the things that, you know, I cannot wait for the day we, Father Peter, you're sending these rays from heaven over my shoulder,
like,
and I'm looking really good, but it's gonna, you guys aren't gonna be able to see me anymore. Okay. Okay, now you see my kitchen. Okay. So, okay, this is the kind of thing that would happen on Zoom, is realism, right? So I'm down here in my living, my dining room today, because my office is being painted, because I'm spending all my time in my office now. But the students have seen me, you know, in different settings as I've had to move. They've seen, you know, my dog, who you just heard barking a little while ago, sorry, you know. So there's also that the professors, I think, seem more human, because we can't pretend not to be human. It doesn't, we still should have strong boundaries and not overshare and all of that sort of thing. But seeing your professor as a full human, instead of just a sort of, you know, expert on something where the person is going to grade you. Anyway, to just get back to the issue of how impressed I was with their sharing and our together over the semester, finding ways to share on topics that could be hard. One of the things that I loved about Zoom, and I don't like, you know, I'm grateful to Zoom, but, you know, really sick of it. But the chat function meant that students could send chats to the whole class, but also we had a system where any student who didn't want to ask their question or make their comment publicly could private chat it to me, or if they didn't want me to know who it was, because I understand that too, private chat it to one of the TAs. And then that person would ask on behalf. And it just started to populate voices. And then we could display that it was safe to ask that respectful question. I really don't understand, but do you think this sometimes? And on the last day, one of the things the students also said, in addition to, you know, thank you and talking about hope, was how much they appreciated how much everybody shared sometimes really hard things.
That's awesome. That's incredible. I was one of those people that thought the questions in my mind but didn't actually ask them, and so that's wonderful. There's a new channel for that, and maybe
yeah,
then
I've got to figure out a way to do it when we're face to face. And I'm going to put my thinking cap on. Oh, there's got to be an app, right, where they could.
So it is a product of a Georgetown education myself, and after seeing my kids go through Georgetown, I know how incredibly impactful a Georgetown education is. What is it for you, and I'll start with you, Maggie, that makes Georgetown's approach to education so unique?
I've been at Georgetown for 25 years. My very first job was at a small liberal arts college, but in a town that my husband didn't live in, and we were looking, and then I found Georgetown. And I'm like many faculty, once I found this place, I found my home as a scholar, a teacher, and a member of a community. And I really mean that honestly. And then in particular, because what I do is ethics from a secular perspective, right? But ethics, Georgetown has ethics in its DNA. The Kennedy Institute of Ethics, right, which is scholar policymakers, teachers at Georgetown, really, so we do real world problems and bring them back into the classroom. It's located on the fourth floor of Healy Hall, which is the iconic building. I teach right on the floor that Jack DeJoy's offices are on. And Jack said to me at one point, geography is mission, right? Who is in the center of the buildings? Well, it's mission and ministry and it's ethics. So to me, that caring about having a moral compass, caring about serving and doing good, and then doing it as a place that's, I mean, wickedly smart faculty who are also out there, because this is the very, very Jesuit approach to, we serve the world. We are engaging outside the gates all the time and bringing people outside the gates in, including in our courses. So that my colleagues are people who are, you know, helping at the State Department or helping the Department of Defense to figure out that use of algorithms for AI-driven weapons happening here at Georgetown. And thank God he's on the side of good and not evil, right? Because that can be a problem. So to me, it's deeply smart people who are trying to make a difference, who care deeply about teaching, And then it's a community. I mean, for those of you who are first-time parents who haven't yet experienced that piece of it, you've experienced it virtually, kind of, but it's not the same. I mean, I was at Georgetown during 9/11, literally on campus the day, right? And then the aftermath and seeing what happened, how we were a community. When the pandemic hit, I mentioned trust a minute ago, Julie, right? That concept of trust. And I've done work with the administration on a variety of things. So I know these people really well. I know the provost and the president, the deans and faculty leaders. And I, from the beginning, I didn't know what we were gonna do, but I knew it was going to be thoughtful, evidence-based, and putting people first, because I've been here for 25 years and I've seen it. When the chips are down and it's not an easy call, and that gave me a lot of comfort and solace, even in the face of such an upside down world.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly would agree with everything you said, Maggie. I thought that was great. I'm really new to Georgetown. It's just my second year here, so I'm still learning a lot about this wonderful and this generative community. And maybe I'll offer three things that I think the sum of them really make us distinct. I suppose each of them you could find elsewhere, but I really find the totality of them to be quite particularly Georgetown. One is our core requirement for studies for undergraduates, which spans across the humanities and the sciences, so courses in theology and philosophy and history and literature and the sciences. And this is something that has roots in the time of St. Ignatius and decisions of the earliest Jesuits, which at the time actually were scandalous, that you would study all of these secular things, and why would you have young Jesuits trained in those sorts of things? But he felt that it's because with an engagement of the world, the broader world, all sorts of knowledge, all sorts of truth, one is a richer person interiorly. And if one's a richer person interiorly, one becomes a more helpful person exteriorly. And as you mentioned before, Julie, when you asked the question, I mean, problem of God is a cornerstone course at Georgetown. That's not the case everywhere, that there's a course that people can look back to. And some of that is both due to having a core, but then also particular decisions being made within the core that says, not all students have to take problem of God, but the vast majority of do. So they get funneled through this one experience. So that would be one. Another thing that I would look at is the international character of the university, both in terms of where the university is located itself. I think of the Cutter campus, for instance, where we draw faculty and staff and administration, and of course, students from. I mentioned tomorrow, I have a call with somebody in Germany. Later, it's with somebody in Saudi Arabia. And then early next week, it's with somebody in Mexico. And so we're drawing from all over. These are students, by the way, that I'm talking with. And so drawing from all over the place, an international character that is really notable here, I think. And maybe the last thing that I would mention, and this bears on something that we do in the Problem of God class, we spend time reading and discussing at length the working group report on slavery, memory, and reconciliation here at Georgetown. Georgetown has a way of moving into its own history. I mean, every university likes to move into the really exciting, triumphant parts of its own history. Who wouldn't want to do that? But Georgetown, I find, courageously is moving into parts of its history that if it could rewrite and say, let's do this differently, we wish we had made different decisions, they would, of course. But we don't have that kind of a cosmic eraser. But how can we look back and remember history differently? Not as a rewriting of history, but how do we privilege voices that haven't been heard so far? And then how do we have people who are part of our family now, most recently, the members of the class of 2024, come to understand who we are so that we can create ourselves again going forward? So those combinations of a core, the international character, and I think the particular way we're working hard to appropriate and understand our own history, when you combine those things, I'm not seeing a Venn diagram with a lot of overlap that have lots of other institutions in there, but we're there.
It's phenomenal, both what you shared. I'll scoot back before my next question to say, Maggie, I took a course my senior year called Good and Evil with the professor Rocco Pareco, And I had to write a paper and go to the bioethics library. And finding the library was one of the most difficult things. I remember walking around Lounger saying, where is this
library? Because it's not in Lounger, it's in Healy Hall. Yeah.
In Healy. So I remember working there and studying there, looking at the tower. It's a really incredible experience. But thank you both for that. So do you believe the philosophy that you're holding for teaching right now in this virtual environment is shared by the other faculty at Georgetown? Are you seeing that in your conversations or knowing by their point of view how they're doing things? Because we have two remarkable faculty members with us, but we are a wider body here.
Can I start with that one, Peter? Right. So thanks. Yes, I've just been gobsmacked at, not surprised, because I having been here for 25 years, I've had a sense of how dedicated but the fact here, that's my husband getting ice. I'm really sorry.
We all need ice at some point.
The house is being painted, so we're just a little upside down as well. Where was I, Julie?
Well, about the fact sharing the philosophy and teaching, and in fact,
oh my God, yes. Okay. So, when many of my faculty colleagues at other universities and colleges, you know, we were Zooming and calling to commiserate, saying, what are you going to do? Are you getting support on how to redesign your course at a moment's notice? Think back in March when we had to do it right on a dime. And then knowing that we had to do it for real and in a more sustainable way for the fall. And their stories, I mean, so such challenge and difficulty and lack of support. And they said, how are you doing? And I said, I once again feel very lucky. So Georgetown has an internationally acclaimed center called the Center for New Designs in Learning and Scholarship, CANDLES. It was founded 25 years ago by Randy Bass, who then became associate provost, right? And it is a huge team of people that are expert in, we call it pedagogical design, where that design takes into account being very intentional about your learning goals, like one of my, and then just goals of the classroom, like one of mine was just literally to support the students through the semester. That was part of the goal of the class, and I explained. But also experts on technology, experts on how to adapt a class, and they are heroes. I just want to announce to everybody, that team at CANDLES, they work 24/7 for 5 months. As every faculty got a chance to redesign their course with them, take webinars, they traveled over Zoom, department by department, so that we could be together to figure out how to adapt our classes and share best practices. They had drop-in office hours for when you couldn't figure out where on Canvas, you know, because some people hadn't used Canvases thoroughly. So just the technical support, this is what you click, let me show you on my screen, all the way to people sharing syllabi, it was all hands on deck and all hands showed up. I'm sure there's some individual professors who had stresses and weren't able to do that, but the vast majority of people, we have listservs, our whole philosophy department has a whole series of meetings we still do, sharing what we figured out that works and doesn't work. I fell in love a little bit more.
Yeah, and one of the great, one of the great things that CANDLES does, Maggie, I don't know if your department did this, is they offer that, of course, for individual instructors. They offer it for groups. They'll offer it for departments as well. So in the summer, the Theology and Religious Studies department all got together, and we kind of had a special session with CANDLES folks, where we could ask questions that might be particular to our discipline, which would be different elsewhere. I mean, we're not asking questions about lab work, for instance, or things like that, but we might be asking about other sorts of things. And so that's been great. But even more broadly, in terms of our own faculty, broader faculty approach to the pedagogy of the semester, I've found almost every meeting that I've been in with faculty, whether it's a formal departmental meeting or quite informal conversation, usually the first topic is going to be, how are the students doing? And so it's asking that. And I hear that, to go back to something I said before, as a real cur personalis question. It's how are they doing as individuals? What part of particular strengths, weaknesses, problems, eases, whatever that they might have? And I find that really is privileged in the faculty conversation.
And you led right into my next question. And it's a question we've been asking throughout the last couple months. How can we, as parents, as faculty members, as a family, support our students during this time at home? learning and being at home.
Yeah, I hesitate to answer that. Not only do I not have a spouse making ice in the kitchen back there, I obviously don't have kids either, so I don't want to tell anybody how to do that job, of course. But you know, I mean, I guess a couple things I've seen that I think what would be helpful. What would I say that I think could help students? Encourage them. You know, encourage them. Remember, this is especially if you're a first year student. These are the first steps on a long journey of Georgetown. And I don't mean an 8-semester or 4-year journey. I mean a lifelong journey, a whole relationship with this university that's going to look very different at different stages. I mean, Julia, I'm sure you feel that yourself, both being a student here. Now you have a different relationship with the university, both working with alumni, but also as a parent, but all still wrapped up in the Georgetown relationship. So encouraging students, ask what they're learning about. I mean, I love that you're able to just rattle off the classes that you heard, you know, Eros and Caritas. I have a preference for Greek and Latin words. And Nero, there was something in there. It was great. But ask what they're engaging in. I think that's exciting for them. And it's also kind of a great pedagogical technique to kind of summarize back what you're learning. How can you put it in a language that somebody who's not in the class is taking? That's something that I would encourage. And maybe the last thing would be, to the extent that you can, to encourage your children to engage at least the professor. I don't know a professor here who wouldn't be delighted to get an email that says, hey, do you have 15 minutes? Would love to chat with you about something. But I think that's true among other students as well. That they want to engage. They want to be a part of a community. And we really have an ability right now to build that on a micro level of a one-on-one conversation. So those might be three things: to encourage, to ask about what they're learning, and to say, hey, what's the communication like with your professors, with your fellow students, and let's deepen it.
Yeah, I love that. I did a couple of things. The very first reading I assigned for the Intro to Ethics class was actually an essay by a faculty woman writing in the Chronicle of Higher Education to other faculty. So it's so beautiful, I share it with my students. She's somebody who's lived through a lot of, she's from the Middle East and has had a long and illustrious career, but she's lived through a lot of crises. She's lived through a refugee crisis, she's lived through a war. And the essay was sharing lessons from when I've been through this before, not a pandemic, but something that completely disrupts the background conditions in which you live, in a way that may be long, uncertain how long, right? If we had an end date, it would make our adaptations easier. And the first thing she said was, expect less of yourself. So that was the theme we started with, not do less necessarily, though you have to be super flexible with what can you do. Mm-hmm. And I was very honest with them about, I find I can do less during the pandemic. You know, 4:30 every day, that's all I got to give, you know? So yes. I would really share it and I'd ask them to share their stories. But that was sort of a grounding. Again, as humans, what do we do when there's been massive disruption, even if you've been spared, which not all of my students were, right? There's also then just fear and worry about relatives and housing and things like that. But just the disruption, and we finally, we use the metaphor, the picture. I said, I'm not a neuroscientist, so I said to them, I'm making this up, but 80% of your brain is offline. Absorbing, processing, adapting, trying to hold it together. So if you find you need to sleep more or less, if you find that it's really hard to focus, it's not just because it's on Zoom, it's because 80% of you is trying to absorb an existential crisis. See, we philosophers get to use things like phrases like that. And it doesn't mean you need to despair. Right, that's where, so we would go through and I would incorporate readings on resilience throughout the whole semester. And in doing that, talk about how, I mean, I shared with them articles that I found helpful. I said, this one helped me. this is who I am and I am enough, you know, and then we just move on. But, you know, and then I knew they also wanted to be fed, right? They don't want to just not do anything. That can form its own kind of depression and the like. So having intellectually and humanistically stimulating explorations together, that also is part of resilience, do you know what I mean? And distraction sometimes. So it's not just check out, because that's not self-care. But adjust your expectations for what we're living through, because you're already being amazing.
I'll ask you one more question, then we'll move on to two questions from our audience. How do you think this experience will change how you teach and work with students, and when we all get to come back together in the classroom again?
Yeah, that's a great question. Maybe I'll kind of take two shots at it. One thing I always did like I've been here forever. I'm 50% of my time here. In fall 2019 and the first half of spring 2020, I took advantage of this great program that operates out of the provost's office, which encourages faculty members to have office hours in a campus coffee shop. And they provide this little coupon that the professor and every student who comes gets a free coffee or something like that. It's really nice, and I had a lot of people come to it just to chat, and often from different classes. I'm going to have to be thinking of more situations like that. I've had people over to the Jesuit residence before. Students, I think, have enjoyed that. They find this kind of this mystical place, like, what exactly is that over there? So basically, I'm thinking to myself, the great good that's come out of those one-on-one 20-minute meetings, what does that look like? So I think about the coffee thing. I think about other things. But that has been so significant and kind of transformative for me to see how helpful that was throughout the whole semester, that I'm determined to keep something like that going, and even better, to be able to do it in person. So that would be kind of one thing that jumps out to me right away of things that I would want to continue as we move on, hopefully soon, to having people in person. But I would say that the second is how to kind of continue things like, as simple as now, whenever I'm assigning a reading in class, the first thing I'm thinking is the author alive? Do I know him or her? And can I get him or her to click a button and join us? Whereas in the past, it was always, I don't know if I have the funds to fly this person in a hotel, and is it worth it for, I might only want you for 30 minutes in the class. Well, how to continue to get creative with that. And now that there's kind of like a worldwide fluency, at least in higher ed, and things like Zoom, it'd be so much easier to arrange something. If somebody said to me 2 years ago, can you Zoom into my class? I wouldn't even know what they meant. I would have thought they meant running in. But now it's so common that I think we can continue to have voices, and think of it as a matter of speaking of expanding a conversation, expanding even a faculty to have colleagues from other places, authors of the materials we're reading, be present right there in the classroom. So I think that'll be exciting when we come back as well.
I love that. I think that's exactly right. I hadn't thought of that as being, I mean, it's exactly right. And I hadn't thought of that as being one of the things that we'll all get from this. I'm going to name one thing that's really concrete and maybe a little geeky. So sorry, but as a, this semester, you all will remember the university compressed the academic calendar. So there weren't any days off. There weren't long weekends, because they were at the time thinking that some students would be on campus and they wanted to discourage traveling back and forth. And for various reasons, you all know the spring semester is going to still have a compressed one within the spring break. And so, so as a teacher, I just know how crucial those days off are. We all just need breathers. The idea of just that I was teaching Monday, Wednesday, that every Monday, every Wednesday, you're going to get more material, you're going to read, you're going to have homework until we all collapse at Thanksgiving, I knew just wasn't realistic psychologically, and it's terrible learning. Anyway, so because I was redesigning everything with the pandemic in mind and forced with that compressed schedule, I actually shifted it's kind of the cadence of the class. There were three units, and I did it so that there were 3 weeks of super fun, amazing, cool, you know, content with different kinds of homeworks, writing, and then creative exercises, and lectures and discussions and all that kind of stuff. But then for each unit, there was what we called a synthesis week, where I was still giving material with lots of integration, or we had panelists come in, but they didn't have any new reading or homework, and those were the weeks for them to write their short unit papers. So usually we just got to, mm-hmm. we try really hard, right, to divide the load, but it's just hard, and this cadence of this is what we do. We do 3 weeks, and then we all look back, and we think, and we talk, and we write, and it opened up so much more room for me to support them with their papers, and I don't think I'll ever go back. Even when we're face to face, I'll keep that kind of cadence. So it helped me teaching.
Nice.
Before I was preparing for a parent webinar last week, I conducted an interview of my two children at Georgetown. I thought I knew everything they thought, but I learned so much from just calling them and asking them a few questions. And one of the things my senior said is she's never seen cura personalis as at work as it is right now with the Georgetown faculty. She said, faculty members are bending over backwards. They're there for you. She does live in Georgetown as a senior, and a professor dropped off a book for her. She said they've extended their office hours. They are giving extensions. And she said, I'd like to see that going forward. It's a competitive environment, but she said she's never felt so supported in her 4 years here. And so, and then has deeper, richer relationships with her professors because of that extra one-on-one time that they've been offering and she's been able to take advantage of. So that is.
And meeting their dogs and cats and small children, you know?
That's right.
These habits. So now we'll turn on thank you for your thoughtful and really powerful answers and time and conversation with me. I'm going to turn it back over to Sarah for some questions from our audience today.
Thank you all so much. It has been delightful listening in, and I appreciate the questions that have come in from our audience. If you have further questions or comments that you'd like to share, you can send those in using the questions area of the GoToWebinar control panel. So two questions from our audience. The first one to start off, what opportunities do the Jesuit principles create for Hoyas that are distinct from other colleges?
I'm happy to just offer a couple things. I think that certainly some aspects of our coursework, like I would offer, I mean, this is a little bit of shameless self-promotion, but I teach the problem of God. I think that's something that is certainly unique to Georgetown. So the course is named after a series of lectures that a Jesuit named John Courtney Murray delivered in 1962 at Yale University. And in addition to having buzz at Georgetown, I find that the statement that the name of the course is the problem of God almost never fails to get some sort of a crack out of people. I mean, even prior to COVID, you know, I'd go home, talk to my family or something. I'm from Long Island, and I'd say, well, what course you teach? Intro to Theology. Is that what it's called, Intro to Theology? No, I'm thinking, here we go. I said, no, it's called Problem of God. Problem of God, huh? So God's a problem, huh? Okay, no. We can talk about it. But, you know, the fact that there's buzz around it and the fact that even it's got just kind of a compelling name, I feel like as a resource, it's really unique to draw. I don't know of any other school that has that name of that course. And then the variety of ways it's appropriated by faculty in theology and religious studies, you can see all sorts of different ways, because the heart of the John Courtney Murray lecture is to look historically at how the problem of God has happened in different eras, but also what does it look like today? And you get professors' takes on what that looks like. And I think that is something that is unique for Hoyas.
Oh, and the retreats too, the opportunities for students to do Ignatian retreats, is that right?
Sure.
Peter, they're shorter, but yeah.
Yeah, they're shorter retreats, and one of the things that I love about it is and I don't know the names of all of them, but they're all named after different cities that were significant in Ignatius's own life. Loyola, a city in northern Spain, Manresa, a city in eastern Spain, not far at all from Barcelona, La Storta, which is a little town just outside of Rome. There's a fourth one. I forget what the fourth one is. It might be Montserrat, also from Spain. But trying to say that in this journey that you're taking on this series of retreats, let's say, during your years here, you're in some way mirroring the journey of Ignatius. It's your journey. And nobody's asking you to repeat Ignatius's own journey. But hey, sometimes it's helpful when one is on a journey. So, how have other people who've been along this pathway traversed it? And we could use him as one example. a cherished example, obviously, in any Jesuit institution.
And Father Folan, that actually ties in really nicely to the second question I want to ask to you all from the audience. What simple ways should parents be recommending to their children to continue their spiritual journeys that are realistic and doable after a week of Zooming? You know, are there any resources for reading or, you know, or books you could recommend? Just some ways to continue that. Mm-hmm.
I'm happy to jump in and just say a couple things. One, I always try to say to people, look, you know, if you're turn about deepening a spiritual relationship, a prayer life, don't forget that when you engage in those things, you don't leave your body. You're in a body. If you're tired, if you've been staring at a screen all week, if you have a million other things to do, you got to be patient with yourself. To pick up on the things that you were saying, Maggie, which I thought were just great, like, you're doing enough. I mean, there's a phrase that's used sometimes in Jesuit circles that can be put different ways in Latin. It's multus, not multa, two Latin words. One means much and one means many things. So in other words, it's not about saying, well, let me get these 30 different things I can do to deepen my spiritual life. No, maybe what's one thing you could do a little bit more deeply? And you know, think about a reading resource, for instance. I think about the wonderful work of my friend, Father Jim Martin, a Jesuit priest, probably the most well-known Jesuit in the country, who writes wonderful books. I mean, you could just go to Amazon and take any of them. That'd be great. There's a wonderful little volume of prayers that are kind of not just written by Jesuits, but inspired by the exercises, called Heart Spiritual Exercise. That's a text that's central to Ignatian spirituality. Hearts on Fire, really short things. We're in a time of year, and I know I'm speaking from a Christian perspective, obviously, but these can also, I think, traverse into interreligious sectors as well. But I'm using an Advent kind of prayer devotional. It's a collection of sermons by an Episcopal priest. Her name is Fleming Rutledge. She's based in Virginia. And so I think little things like that for me, kind of either short prayers or great little reflections from Jim or these homilies by Fleming Rutledge, they're digestible. They recognize the fact that I'm tired, but they still nourish me.
Wonderful. Thank you. That's great. Julie, this question sort of more for you. As a parent, what has impressed you most about the ability to retain the Jesuit ethos amid virtual learning and student engagement?
Virtual learning, student engagement. I immediately think of Jesuits' ethos of meeting us where we live and having that strong ethic in the education at Georgetown in for each student in the sense of cura personalis, our faculty leaning in and meeting our students where they are in their homes with their families under stress, understanding the physical and mental limitations to it all. I've seen that come through, and I've seen that level of compassion through the screen for my children. And I think that it supports them in this process and makes them feel stronger and know that they can get through it. That's just off the top of my head.
Great, thank you. Another great question, and feel free to keep sending them in. I know we have about 5 minutes left together. Maggie, maybe you can start off with this one, but equity as an ethical concept is front and center in this pandemic world of limited resources. How is it being addressed in classrooms?
Well, I don't know who sent that question in, but I love you. Yeah, so equity in the pandemic was one of the weeks we spent in the course. How it's being addressed at Georgetown, I think, first of all, the university has been exceptionally dedicated to finding out and responding to students who are in need. And the need can be, I mean, some of our students and some of you on the phone will have these experiences, right? We're lucky to have a diverse community, and that including socioeconomically. So some students, I mean, shared stories of you know, just not having a home to live in because the person they were living with then got stuck in their home country, right? And so what happens with that? So putting resources into taking care of our most vulnerable, right, is a critical ethical principle of equity, that it's not just give the same to everybody, it's you have to be attuned to who has vulnerabilities or multiple vulnerabilities. The idea that, I'll just give another example, the university is bent over backward financially to not have to let staff go, including unionized cleaning staff, right? So in the spring, when everything shut down, buildings are locked, we can't even get into our offices, right, to get our papers back. And so none of them are being cleaned, and the cleaning staff was paid. And that doesn't happen at every university. So it really is not just when can we get back and, you know, I can get back into my office and when do I get the vaccine? And then mentioning the vaccine. So I will also say Georgetown scholars are amongst those who are Henry Richardson, famously philosophy department, as I mentioned, at Georgetown, people go out in the real world. And he was on the committee with the World Health Organization urging what the prioritization for vaccine disbursement should be, right? So also the policy level of Georgetown is having a voice there. It really matters.
Father Folan and Julie, anything to add?
I might add, it's a real micro thing. Maggie's hit so many of the great ways that Georgetown is trying to address questions of equity. So really micro for me in the classroom would be something like, recognizing that when we're in a brick and mortar classroom, it can disguise a whole lot of differences. We're all sitting at the same types of desks or the same types of chairs, listening to the same lecture or participating in the same conversation, all with the same basic tools at our fingertips, usually a pen and paper. That's different when we're on Zoom. And so, like, for instance, I made clear from the get-go, if for whatever reason you don't want to have your camera on, I understand that. I mean, I like it when people do, but I understand there can be reasons of equity at times when people don't. It might be something about what they would see behind them. Is the computer advanced enough to be able to do kind of one of the virtual backgrounds on Zoom? So those are questions that I think are fair. So I want to give people the freedom not to stress about that. And I always have a line in my syllabus, and it's not a throwaway line. If the acquisition of any of these materials or anything else, it provides any sort of a burden for you, please contact me. And I have been contacted every semester I've been here, and we work at a place where there are many resources, and thankfully professors know about them, and we can contact different offices within the university and say, how can we help here? And it's not that you're then jumping into a pool of red tape. You really have the ability to help people.
Wonderful, thank you. Two final questions to close us out. One, what can I say to my child to give her hope that she will eventually have a quote unquote real college experience, you know, to hold out the hope?
Well, I think that Father Folan said at the beginning, this is just the beginning. It's the beginning of a lifelong relationship with Georgetown and in this community that Maggie spoke about so beautifully before. This is just the beginning. We will get through this time and we will be together on campus here, hopefully sooner than later. And the journey is just beginning, and it will continue the rest of one's life here at Georgetown. It has for me, I know it has for others in our community. And just knowing that, you can tell your daughter that there's nothing but goodness to come.
Oh, I love that, Julie. And this idea of reorienting them across time, right? So that it's a story, it's a journey. So you might even think of saying, imagine it's your fourth year at Georgetown and you had 3 years of, you know, being on campus and doing all of these sort of things. How would you describe, looking back, how would you describe this year in a journal, for instance? Because it can help them to have a lens on now that's from a future that's better.
Yeah, and I think in addition to what you're both saying about stoking hope, I think also recognize people are doing what they can. This is going to end at some point. The experience of the class of 2024 in a now going on a 230 plus year history of the university, has a special place in the university's life. That might be, you know, kind of small potatoes, but if one is a lover of history, that's a significant thing. And there are kind of interesting things at play. I just got an email yesterday from the Vice President of Mission and Identity here, Father Mark Bosco, to a group of Jesuits saying, would any of you be interested in having like a Jesuit type book sort of club thing, not for credit, where you might get a handful of students who'd want to read a book that you would think is significant, that you just, maybe not from your discipline. I've never been contacted about anything like that before, something like this. So there are creative ideas happening too. I hope that that can kind of fan the embers of hope a little bit and turn it into a flame.
That's such a great message to close out on. Thank you to the three of you for this wonderful session. It's been such a pleasure having you all with us. Thank you for sharing your time. To our great audience, thank you for your questions and your participation and for being with us this afternoon. Julie, any final words as we move to close out?
Well, just to thank you for joining with us today and wishing everyone happy holidays this month.
Many thanks.
Thank you all. Hoya Saxa.
Hoya Saxa.